Right, the last topic that we're going to talk about is cytokines. Excuse me. We'll discuss some general properties of cytokines and then look at some examples, certainly not all the cytokines that are known, but we'll just handpick a few of them, talk about some of their major biological properties, where they come from. And then I want to end with a short discussion of immunoregulation. We've sort of been talking about immunoregulation as we've gone on, but there's a few things, other ways that the immune system is regulated that we want to just point out. So we'll start with cytokines, these non-antibody mediators between cells. Now, the nomenclature here is really can be very, very confusing. You hear these things called by all sorts of names. You'll hear some people talk about monokines, and other people will talk about lymphokines, and they're all basically fall under this major class called cytokines. The monokines are called monokines basically because they were synthesized by mononuclear cells, monocytes, and macrophages. Lymphokines were things that were produced by lymphocytes. When these things first were discovered, they were actually given names based on the functions. For example, I told you that the IL-2, its original name was T-cell growth factor. And what happened was a lot of these cytokines have multiple functions. So sometimes these cytokines had multiple names. Depending upon who was studying it and what function they were studying, they would name it this way. So there was an attempt among the powers that be to try to standardize the nomenclature, and they came up with this term interleukin. And an interleukin is just nothing else but a cytokine that works between leukocytes. And, of course, they use the IL designation, then followed by some number, which you're familiar with a lot of these cytokines. It was nice to have a standardized nomenclature. The problem is that those functional names really helped. I mean, interleukin 2 doesn't tell you a lot of what it does. T-cell growth factor, you knew exactly what it did. But we're stuck with the IL number and the numbers, and that's the way it's going to be. They're produced by a variety of cells, and we'll talk about some of the cells that produce them with some of these main cytokines. Now, one of the things is that these cytokines are newly made all the time. Our cells don't preform these things and store them in granules. These are always made as needed. So there's always going to be a delay before they actually appear, because for example, upon a macrophage, once it's one of its toll-like receptors gets activated, it's going to take some time. It's going to have to transcribe the cytokine gene, it's going to have to translate that protein, and then secrete that protein. So there's always a delay from the time that the cell receives a signal to the time that the cytokine is needed. Cytokines actually produced, and they're not produced for long amounts of time. Okay, they actually. Well, we're going to say that, for example, macrophages make this particular cytokine, but in fact, oftentimes many cells make these same cytokines, and these cytokines have multiple effects. They're said to be pleiotropic. They can work on a lot of different cell types. Okay, and one of the reasons. They're said to be redundant because many of the cytokines have very, very similar modes of action. And there's a reason for that. What I'm showing you here is the receptors that are used for some of these cytokines. So if you look at IL-2, IL-15, IL-7, IL-9, their receptors usually are either heterodimers or heterotrimers oftentimes, and they share subunits. So for example, you could see all of these cytokines share some certain subunits, like this one here, the IL-2 R gamma. They all have that thing. And so consequently, all of these cytokines can have very similar effects because the signaling pathways that are activated are very similar for all of them. And there's a reason why that's important in the immune system, because what happens if we have a defect in IL-2 where we can't produce IL-2, IL-2 is a key cytokine in the immune system. But people that have deficiencies in IL-2 they do quite well because we have all these others that can have similar activities. All right, so there is some redundancy in this cytokine system, but the redundancy is there for a purpose. On the other hand, you know, if you knock out something like this, the IL-2 receptor gamma gene, you essentially wipe out the activity of all those cytokines, and that is a very serious defect. In fact, that's one of the severe combined immunodeficiencies, is actually a defect in the IL-2 gamma part of the receptor, because both B cells and T cells are using these receptors, and so if you knock out that common subunit, it becomes a serious defect. If you knock out one of these others, it's not a problem because of the redundancy. Very often what you see in cytokines is a cascade of effects. And the classic example is the inflammatory cytokines. Once TNF is produced, it leads to the production of IL-1, which then leads to the production of IL-6, and you get a wave of cytokines, IL-TNF, and then IL-1, then IL-6 produced. And very often these things have very similar effects, and these are the main cytokines involved in inflammation. The presence of one can positively influence the synthesis of another or negatively influence the synthesis of another. You can have antagonistic or additive effects. They can be synergistic effects. So all of these things are possible when it comes to cytokines. And they can work in an autocrine, paracrine, or endocrine fashion. They can work on the same cell that secretes it, and we give an example of that with the macrophages secreting TNF, and that TNF can in turn activate the macrophage. It can activate nearby macrophages, a paracrine, or an endocrine effect. And again, the responses to the cytokines are also going to be slow, primarily because the cytokine is going to lead to the production of something else and turn on some genes, and that takes some time. You've got to transcribe those new genes and translate them. Okay, so let's just look at some of the main cytokines and discuss the cells that produce them and some of their main biological functions. Now, any way that you try to organize or categorize cytokines is essentially going to be doomed to failure because these things have multiple effects. And so I've listed them this way, mediators of natural immunity, but I think you'll see immediately, how do I put interferon gamma here? Well, obviously that's something that's part of the specific immune system as well. So these things are going to have multiple things. I've put them this way, but keep in mind that it's not a good classification system, okay? But the ones we'll discuss are TNF-alpha, IL-1, 10, 12. We haven't talked a lot about the type 1 interference when Dr. Margaret Hunt comes back within the virology section. She'll be discussing with you in a little more detail the antiviral properties of these type 1 interferons. We'll make a couple comments about that. Interferon gamma and the chemokines. So let's start with TNF-alpha. TNF-alpha primarily produced by macrophages, okay? And again, this is one of the main cytokines that's important in activating macrophages together with either the TNF-alpha or the LPS and gram-negative bacteria. It has the ability to recruit neutrophils and activate them. What it does is it stimulates the expression of ICAM on endothelial cells. So the endothelial cells then are now expressing this. This allows the macrophages and the PMNs to bind and diapedes and get into the tissue spaces. It also stimulates them to produce chemokines. We'll talk about chemokines. These are nothing else but chemotactic cytokines. It doesn't all have effect just on the immune system. It also affects the hypothalamus. It's a pyrogen. This is one of the pyrogens. Causes fever, okay? And promotes the production of the acute phase proteins. Interleukin-1 is another one of these cytokines that's produced, inflammatory cytokines that's produced by macrophages, and it has properties very, very similar to TNF-alpha. So basically the same things we said about IL-1, TNF-alpha also apply to IL-1. For example, it is a pyrogen. It actually also induces fever. So it has the same type of activity. And this is one of these main inflammatory cytokines. Again, the three inflammatory cytokines, the main ones are TNF-alpha, IL-1, and IL-6. And these are the ones that they have this cascade effect. It also participates in the activation of T cells. When macrophages are presenting antigen to T cells to activate the T cells, the main thing, of course, is the interaction of antigen and the T cell. But in addition, the macrophage, by secreting IL-1, that helps in the activation of those T cells as well. Interleukin 10. This one is produced by macrophages, and of course, if you remember, this is one of the Th2 cytokines, so it's also produced by Th2 cells. IL-10 is primarily an inhibitory cytokine, so it's there to help dampen immune responses. We saw when we talked about the Th1, Th2 that it was produced by these gamma 1 cells and shifts the response to the IL-2 because it blocks the production of the interferon gamma by Th1 cells, and so you drive the response to a Th2 type response. It can inhibit the production of a lot of different cytokines, and that's why we say it's primarily an inhibitory cytokine. It inhibits the expression of class 2 MHC molecules and co-stimulatory molecules. What effect is that going to have? If you inhibit the production of the accessory molecules and the class 2 MHC molecules, you're going to dampen the immune response because those are the things, those accessory molecules are necessary to keep to make a strong interaction between the antigen-presenting cell and the helper cell. If you don't have class 2 antigen, you can't present to the T helper cells. So it acts to help dampen the immune response, one of the ways that the immune response is regulated. IL-12, again, produced by macrophages, and dendritic cells by the antigen-presenting cell. And again, whether it produces this is influenced by what antigen it encounters. That's how the response to either drive it to a Th1 or Th2 response is determined, whether or not you're producing these different cytokines. And, of course, it leads to the production of interferon gamma because it drives differentiation of the helper cell towards a Th1 phenotype. Okay. It also enhances the cytolytic functions of T cells and NK cells. So it has multiple effects. The type 1 interferons, interferon alpha and beta, these are produced by macrophages, and actually a lot of different cell types produce these interferons. And it does have antiviral activity. It inhibits the viral replication. And Dr. Hunt will go into some detail as to how interferons actually carry out their antiviral activity. but they lead to the increased expression of class 1 MHC. And so what's that going to do? You're increasing class 1 MHC. What effect is that going to have? Well, what effect would increased class 1 MHC expressed on cells have? The cytotoxic T cells, they recognize antigen in context of class 1 MHC. So this actually makes the cells more susceptible to cytotoxic killing. And what you have going on here, I told you when we talked about the NK cells, that one of the things that viruses do is they tend to downregulate class 1 MHC so that you can avoid TCL killing. Here you have this cytokine trying to upregulate it so the interference can help upregulate. So you have this battle going on between the immune system and the virus. And it also activates NK cells. Interferon gamma, one we've talked about it in a number of instances, a real key cytokine produced by Th1 cells. Now, some other cells can produce this. Cytotoxic cells, NK cells, they actually produce interferon gamma, but not nearly as much as the Th1 cell. This is the Th1 cell is the main cell. And we've talked about a lot of these different functions, activating NK cell. This one also induces both class 1 and class 2 antigen expression goes up after exposure to interferon gamma. Again, boosting making the cell more susceptible to cytotoxic cells, also making the cells better antigen-presenting cells. Interferon gamma participates in the differentiation of B cells. It actually stops B cell division so that B cells then differentiate into plasma cells. It activates T cells. We talked about the fact that it activates macrophages. It does actually have some antiviral activity, just like the alpha and beta interferon, but the antiviral activity of interferon gamma is really low compared to the other other types of interferon. And it can activate granulocytes as well. So it plays a number of different roles that we've already discussed. The chemokines are cytokines that basically act as chemotactic factors. And they're produced by a number of different kinds of cells. And there's a whole slew of these things. Some of them will selectively attract lymphocytes. Some of them will selectively attract PMNs. For example, IL-8 is one that can act to selectively attract PMN. So there's a whole variety of these things. And of course, they participate then in lymphocyte trapping. That's one of the ways that lymphocytes are directed, or leukocytes in general, are directed to the sites where infection is going on by these various chemokines. And there's too many of them to try to go through all of them. There's a whole slew of these things. They fall into the general category called chemokines. All right. The next group are those that are involved in adaptive immunity. Again, obviously both IL-10 and interferon gamma fall into this category as well. And that's why I said there's no really good way to try to categorize these cytokines. But the ones we'll talk about are 2, 4, 5, and TNF-beta. Okay, IL-2, again, produced primarily by helper cells, although other cells can produce it, even cytotoxic cells will produce it. It's just that they don't do it as well. Mainly it's a Th cytokine, and which helper cell? Th1. This is a Th1 cytokine. Okay, it's the IL-2. As I said, is a T cell growth factor. It also stimulates the growth of B cells, so it participates in that way by when the B cells are activated. This is one of the growth factors that's used to multiply or increase the population of cells. We've already said it's an NK activator. It's also can activate monocytes. Right, so playing a central role in the immune system. Now, when IL-2, in the case of T cells, IL-2 works in an autocrine, in an autocrine role. What happens when you activate a T cell? Once a T cell gets activated by receiving antigen from the helper cell, what actually happens is the T cell begins to express, one of the things when it gets activated is that it expresses now the receptor for IL-2. So the cells begin to express the receptor for IL-2. They also secrete IL-2. So the IL-2 then works in an autocrine fashion and to drive the division of that cell. And then as the cells lose that receptor, then they're no longer susceptible to IL-2. They stop dividing. And again, this is one of the ways that we dampen the immune response, so we don't let it go. By the receptor being made for a time and then being turned off, we basically become refractory to the effects of IL-2. And that's, again, one of the ways that the immune system is going to be regulated. Interleukin-4, again, produced by macrophages. Again, this is that cytokine that drives differentiation towards the Th2 phenotype. It's also produced by the Th2 cells and stimulates their production. Promotes the growth and differentiation of the Th2 cells. This is one of these cytokines that has an effect on class switching. This produces primarily, again, it shifts the response towards an IgE response. IL-5 is one of the Th2 cytokines. This is also one of the cytokines that promotes the growth and differentiation of B cells. This is what drives a B cell to differentiate into a plasma cell, these interleukins that are produced by the Th2 cells. TGF-beta is primarily another one of these inhibitory cytokines to help regulate the immune response. It's produced by T cells and macrophages and actually a variety of other cell types. But it blocks the activity of macrophages. It blocks the activation. It acts on PMNs and endothelial cells to dampen responses, basically. So it is essentially, like IL-10, it is one of the main inhibitory cytokines. In the last group of cytokines I just want to mention are the stimulators of hematopoiesis. These are generally referred to as colony stimulating factors. And the reason they got their name was actually the way they were discovered. What was done was to take cells from the bone marrow and plate cells from bone marrow in an agar dish, in the agar, so they were mobilized in the agar, and then you would treat with these various substances, and then you would look to see what effect they had on the cells. Each cell that plated in this agar would form this little colony, and then you would take out that colony, look at the colony, look at the morphology. And so that's why these things became known as colony stimulating factors. These are factors that stimulated the growth of bone marrow cells and then drove the differentiation. So you have things like GM-CSF, granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor. This was a factor that stimulated the growth of progenitor cells in the bone marrow, differentiated into granulocytes and macrophages. Macrophage colony stimulating factor promoted the development of macrophages, and then your granulocyte stimulating factor obviously makes granulocytes. So that's why these things are called CSFs, or colony stimulating factors, basically how they were discovered. Now, one thing to keep in mind again is that these cytokines have multiple effects, and not just in the immune system. They were first identified and described in the immune system, but in fact they have effects on other cells. Cytokines like IL-6, for example, have an effect on the liver. TNF, IL-6, IL-1 all affect the brain. So there's a lot of interplay. So you really, when you talk about cytokines, we're talking about a network of interactions. And it's not just in this direction. It also goes in this direction. Other cells produce cytokines that then influence the immune system. So there's a lot of crosstalk going on because of these cytokines. So you're really talking about a network of interactions with the cytokines. Okay. Yeah, I want to end with just a brief discussion of regulation of the immune system. Now, the magnitude of any immune response is going to be determined by a couple of things. Obviously, the presence of antigen driving the immune response in a forward. But then there's also these negative regulatory influences that help to block or suppress the immune system. And it's a balance then between antigen driving the immune system and other things that are acting in an inhibitory mechanism. And there are a number, but we've actually talked about a number of these things. These regulatory mechanisms can act at any stage along the way. It can act at the recognition phase. There can things that can block recognition of antigen. Obviously, if anything blocks recognition, that's going to have a negative effect on the thing. It may block not the recognition, but the actual activation of the cells. Or it can work at the effector phase, having effect on the effector cell itself, the CT, the cytotoxic T cell, or the effector macrophage. So any step along the way, you can have regulation. And we, again, as I said, we've talked about some of these. I'll remind you. We talked about, remember when we were talking about the cell-cell interactions or activation, we said that co-stimulation was necessary, and I showed you that one slide that said if you have engagement of the T cell receptor without co-stimulation, not only do you not get a response, but you actually induce a state of energy. So that's an example where you dampen the immune response. We went on to show you that after a T cell gets activated, it starts making this CTLA-4, which also binds to that same B7. That again dampened the response because you no longer have the activation. It actually sends an inhibitory signal. That was an example of how you can regulate the immune response. We just talked about cytokines having inhibitory or positive effects. The main inhibitory cytokines being IL-10 and TGF, transforming growth factor. We talked about idiotype, anti-idiotype as a way of regulating immune response, because some of those anti-idiotypes were positively regulating, some of those were negatively regulating. So we've actually talked about a number of different ways that the immune responses can be regulated. But there are a couple others that I want to mention. And what is antibody? Antibody actually acts as a regulator of antibody production. And it can do so actually in one of two ways. One is a simple competition. Obviously, once you have soluble antigen, or soluble antibody being produced, that soluble antibody is going to be competing with the antibody that's the presence on the surface of the B cell for binding antigen. If antigen binds to the soluble antibody, it's not going to be available to be binding to the the immunoglobulin on the surface of the B cell. Once we no longer have antigen here, we have no activating signal anymore. And so the cell is going to, antibody itself, its sheer presence as a soluble antibody actually competes with the immunoglobulin on the surface for activating the B cell. But there's another way that antibody actually regulates, and that is via binding to the Fc receptor. If you have an antibody, this was a soluble antibody I went to, it binds antigen, it can then bind to the Fc receptors. B cells have Fc receptors for IgG. And the binding of the antibody antigen complex to the Fc receptor sends an inhibitory signal. So even if the antigen is activating the cell, the fact that you have the Fc receptor engaged actually blocks the activation. And so antibody immune complex is essentially binding to Fc receptors on B cells is a way of regulating the immune response and dampening the immune response. And then finally, I just want to make a couple comments about a group of cells that are known as Tregs. This is really interesting. When I first started in immunology back in my postdoc days, the rage at that time was something called suppressor T cells. Everybody talked about suppressor T cells. You couldn't go to a meeting or anything without, you know, zillions of papers on suppressor T cells. And then they just dropped out of existence, like, you know, you never heard anything about T cells. Well, they're back, people. Now they're called Tregs, but they're back. We don't know a lot of actually how they work, but I'll tell you a couple things about the Tregs, because these things are really, really in vogue today. Everybody's looking at the effect of Tregs on various aspects of the immune system. And so you're by the time you guys get out there, you may be actually hearing more about Tregs, so at least you'll know what they are, although I can't tell you much about how they work, because we don't really know how they work. What they do, they don't seem to prevent the activation of the cell. The cells get activated, but they block the activity of the cell. They dampen the response so that you don't get chronic activation of the immune system. So it's not blocking the actual activation. Cells get activated, and then they get turned off by the Treg cells, essentially. They don't have the characteristics of either a Th1 cell or a Th2 cell, but they can actually suppress both types of responses. So these are cells which can suppress immune responses once they've started. And there's a number of different types of these Tregs have been described. The first one is just a naturally occurring Treg. This one is actually produced in the thymus. The thymus generates some Tregs. And they have the following cell surface or markers that are used to identify them. They're CD4 positive, so they are in the helper cell group. They're CD25 positive. Now, CD25 is actually part of the IL-2 receptor. So they express an IL-2 receptor. They are CD4 positive. And they express this particular protein, FOXP3. And what that is actually a transcription factor. And it's an important transcription factor in these cells, because if you actually don't have that transcription factor, people that have defects in that transcription factor are very susceptible to development of autoimmune and chronic inflammatory type diseases. So it must play a key role in the immune system. And these cells express it. And in fact, this is what is the most characteristic of these cells. All the true Tregs that have been described are always FOXP3 positive. So in other words, this is the thing that distinguishes a cell as a Treg, the expression of that particular transcription factor. These, as I said, they arise in the thymus. They're naturally occurring, but how they actually carry out their function is not known. They seem to be, cell-cell contact is necessary. for them to work. So if you keep the cells apart, it's not going to be via cytokines and that. So cell-cell interaction is actually, but the actual mechanism has not been established. There's lots of speculation as to what it might be, but the bottom line is we don't know how these things work. We know that they exist. We know that they have this suppressive activity. We just don't know how they're doing it yet. There's another group of Tregs that can be induced by antigen, and they're induced by antigen, and then one of these inflammatory or negatively inhibitory type cytokines, either IL-10 or TGF-beta. Those that are induced by IL-10 have the following phenotype. They're CD4 positive, CD25 negative, and FOXP3 negative. So strictly speaking, this cell is not a true Treg, so they give it a different name, and that's why these cells were called TR1 cells. These are regulatory cells of some sort, but they're not a Treg because they don't express that FOX3. So if the cells exposed to antigen and IL-10 can be induced to become a Treg and a regulatory T cell having that phenotype, and these act apparently by just secreting more IL-10, so they just cause a lot of secretion of IL-10, and IL-10 is an inhibitory cytokine. The other induced regulatory cell is a bona fide Treg because it does express FOXP3, and this is expressed by exposure to antigen and TGF-beta, and again, it acts by stimulating the secretion of TGF-beta, which is, again, the inflammatory or inhibitory cytokine. And finally, there is a CD, these are not just CD4 positive cells, there is a CD8 Treg as well, and this is an induced one. It's induced by antigen and IL-10. Now, this one has been certainly demonstrated in vitro. It has not been shown to exist yet in vivo, so we don't know whether or not this is just some sort of laboratory artifact or if it's a true cell. But it has the FOXP3, so it has the characteristics of a true Treg. And how it works is partly by cytokines, but cell-cell contact seems to be necessary as well. So again, I'm purposely being vague here because we really don't know how these things work. There's a lot of interest in them, and a lot of people are studying these regulatory T cells. It is clear that they suppress immune responses, and that's basically the bottom line for you guys, that there are cells out there that act as suppressor cells as well. So we have activating T cells and then suppressing T cells that help dampen these immune responses. Okay, any questions?